The arrangement of the Quran is one of many reasons why Muslims believe that it could only have come from God. In fact, modern research has discovered a remarkable structure in the Quran known as ring composition. To demonstrate this, let's analyze the second chapter of the Quran known as Al-Baqarah, the cow. This chapter consists of a total of 286 verses. The entire chapter can be divided into 9 groups based on theme. The first group of verses talk about faith and unbelief. This mirrors the theme of the last group of verses. The second group covers God's creation and knowledge. This again mirrors the second to the last group's theme. The third group discusses the law given to the Israelites, which mirrors the giving of law to the Muslims in the seventh group. The fourth group relates to the test of Abraham, a mirror of the test of Muslims in the sixth group. The middle group, the fifth group, is the central theme of the entire chapter, the change in direction of the Muslim prayer. We have made you believers a middle nation, so that you may bear witness to the truth before others. We only made the direction the one you used to face in order to distinguish those who follow the messenger from those who turn on their heels. This turning point was the change in direction of the daily prayers from Jerusalem to Mecca, which represented a big test for the believers. We find the mention of this important turning point in exactly the middle of the chapter, the 143rd verse. Moreover, this verse even contains the word middle. Together, these 9 groups form a giant ring composition. As you can see, ring composition is structured as a sort of circle, with the central meaning placed at the center. You can think of it in terms of a mirror. So ring composition is the equivalent of putting a mirror in the middle. What is mentioned in the first half will be reflected in the second half. Things can be taken a step further. If we examine these 9 groups, we find that they each contain sub-ring compositions. So what we have is rings within rings. For example, here is the 8th group with the theme of God's creation and knowledge. We can see that the beginning and the end both have the themes of giving and charity, and the central theme of God's power and knowledge is placed in the middle. Things can be taken further still. This sub-ring contains yet another ring within itself. This is the 255th verse known as Ayat al-Kursi, the verse of the throne. Just like the chapter which contains it, the verse of the throne can be divided into 9 groups based on theme. The first and ninth parts each mention God's personal names. The second and eighth parts both state that God never tires. The third and seventh parts describe that God owns everything in the heavens and the earth. The fourth and sixth parts make it clear that God has total control over us and we are dependent on Him. Notice that the middle of this verse mentions before and after, which could be yet another allusion to the mirroring of ring composition. It's worth highlighting that not only does the verse of the throne contain its own ring composition, but it is also positioned as a sub-ring within 2 larger rings, a concentric ring composition. We can see that this chapter of the Quran is marvelously designed, being precisely and tightly arranged according to the principles of ring composition. This precision in arrangement is in fact astonishing when we consider the timing of the revelation of these verses. To appreciate this, let's consider the analogy of building construction. Imagine you had the task of building a house. Rather than waiting until you receive all of the materials and then drawing up a carefully thought out design plan, you instead decide to proceed without complete knowledge of the constituent parts, constructing it piecemeal, adding to it bit by bit as and when you receive the individual materials. What are the chances that this approach will result in a well-constructed house? Unlike an organized approach where each part is placed in its best possible position according to a design plan, instead you have a situation where it seems each part is placed arbitrarily, depending on the order in which the parts were received. In such circumstances, you would most likely end up with a very poorly designed house, liable to collapse at any time. It is highly unlikely, perhaps even impossible, that this disorganized approach would end up with the same stunningly designed house as an organized approach. Yet this is exactly what we find with the Quran's structure. The builder in our example is the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The house that he began to build since its first verses were revealed to him is the Quran. The rooms and bricks in our construction example are its chapters and verses. He can never have a design plan in place for the Quran because the revelation of many of its verses depended on events that were out of his control, such as the social developments and challenges that he faced throughout his prophethood. For example, believers would come up to him and question him on a particular matter, or his enemies would challenge him. The responses in the form of revelation would then descend on him, addressing the specific situation that he was facing. How could Muhammad have devised such an intricate plan when he could not predict the events that would dictate the revelation of verses? Such an arrangement would have to be planned in advance, but this was not possible due to these events being out of his control. What this demonstrates is that the author was someone who could predict the future. Possessing knowledge of the unseen is a quality of God, not human beings. Some critics may point out that books prior to the Quran had this literary style and therefore we cannot use this as an evidence for the Quran's divine origin. However, comparing the Quran to other books is like comparing night and day for many reasons. Firstly, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was not a poet nor did he have any literary reputation. In fact, like many people at the time, he could not read or write. Secondly, most people would assume that the Quran is arranged chronologically, starting with the first revealed verse and ending with the final revealed verse. This is the order in which books are typically written, in a logical sequence, starting with the beginning, then the middle, and finally the end. But the way the Quran was composed is unlike any other book. Al-Baqarah, the chapter of the Quran that we have covered, was not revealed starting with verse 1, followed by verse 2, then 3, and so on. Rather, its verses were revealed out of sequence, over a span of many years, and interspaced with the revelation of verses from other chapters. The Quran's unusual manner of revelation makes implementing ring composition much more difficult than conventional books. Thirdly, conventional books follow an editorial process by undergoing multiple stages of editing, which allows the author to gradually refine the text over time. However, the Quran did not undergo an editorial process. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, would place the verses in their positions as soon as they were revealed to him. With each new verse, he would not go off and review what had been previously revealed to see where he can position them in order to maintain a ring structure. Rather, spontaneous revelation was immediately followed by the placement of the verse, its position fixed. When we look at the history of the Quran's compilation, there is not a single instance of a verse being moved around in order to make it fit a ring composition. Fourthly, achieving ring composition in conventional books is much more feasible as the author has complete control over the content, allowing them to plan their structure ahead of time. As we've already seen with the Quran, its content was circumstantial as it was tied to events that were out of the control of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and therefore he could not plan a structure ahead of time. Fifthly, the Quran was first revealed as an oral recitation, not in written format. With written books, you can easily plan a structure because you can quickly and conveniently refer back to what you have written previously. But with a recited text like the Quran, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, would have had to rely on his memory in order to recall what was previously revealed, a much greater challenge. In light of all these difficult circumstances, wouldn't you expect the Quran's structure to be jumbled? What we find, against all odds, however, is that the Quran contains a remarkably sophisticated structure. The circumstances of the Quran's revelation, together with its precision and harmony, represent a compelling argument for its divine origin. Your companion is neither astray nor being misled, nor does he say anything of his own desire. It is no less than inspiration sent down to him. He was taught by one mighty in power.
What are the qualities that one would expect to find in genuine revelation from God? If the Creator is perfect and has knowledge of all things, then surely his true revelation must be free of error. Anything less than this can only lead to one conclusion. We are dealing with the imperfect words of man and not the divine. History has not been kind to scripture. The vast majority of religious texts today have been passed down to us through scribal tradition, whereby manuscripts were copied by hand, word for word, letter by letter. Naturally, this method of preservation is prone to human error. Any mistakes, such as in spelling or missing words, made whilst copying, would then be transferred down every time a copy of the copy was made. Extend this process over hundreds or thousands of years, and you can imagine how much a text can change over such a long span of time, as accidental and intentional changes gradually creep in. This is why, for example, we find that there are a multitude of different versions of the Bible in existence today. It's not possible to compare the modern text to the earliest copies, because they were written on fragile and perishable materials, such as papyrus. Therefore, scholars of the Bible have the difficult task of sifting through thousands of later copies, all of which differ. And because the original copies have been lost, they can't agree on which surviving copies are most accurate to the original. So, each version of the Bible that exists is a patchwork of different copies combined together and represents what a particular scholar or group of scholars estimate to be the closest to the original. And so, for texts that have relied on preservation through manual copying, we can say that we have, at best, an estimate of the original words. We certainly cannot say that the text we have today is an accurate representation of the original. What about the Quran? The author of the Quran makes a bold claim. We have sent down the Quran ourselves, and we ourselves will guard it. God blessed his final revelation, the Quran, with something that was not bestowed on any of the prior scriptures. He promised to protect and preserve it from any corruption. Unlike other scriptures, the primary means of preserving the Quran has and always will be through memorization. And we have certainly made the Quran easy for remembrance. So is there any who will remember? Prophet Muhammad was tasked by God with memorizing, transmitting, and explaining the verses of the Quran to the Muslims as they were revealed to him. In turn, these Muslims who had learnt the Quran directly from Prophet Muhammad himself passed on what they had memorized to neighboring tribes and nations. This legacy of mass memorization has continued throughout history. This oral tradition spanning nearly 1500 years has seen the Quran being passed down from teacher to student in an unbroken chain, going all the way back to Prophet Muhammad himself. Today, it is estimated there are many millions of Muslims of all cultures and various ages who have memorized the entire Quran from cover to cover in its original Arabic form. In fact, if every written copy of religious scripture in existence today were to be removed from the earth, it is the Quran alone that could be recreated perfectly and restored in written form once again. This, thanks to its mass memorization. The oral tradition of the Quran is a phenomenon unique to Islam. If millions of people who have memorized the Quran can trace their oral memorization down centuries of teachers and scholars, all the way back to the Prophet himself, who could doubt the authenticity of this oral tradition? The amount of varying oral transmissions, along with the amount of people who have learnt the Quran, and the fact there are no discrepancies in what they have memorized, is no historical coincidence. The conclusion can only be that the Quran memorized today is the same as it was taught over 1400 years ago. There is no other rational explanation for this unique oral phenomenon. In addition to the mass memorization of the Quran, another unique aspect of its preservation is that the rules and regulations for pronouncing each individual letter have also been safeguarded. This ensures that Muslims not only recite the same content as Prophet Muhammad, but in the exact same style. An easy way to appreciate the significance of preserving the recitation style of the Quran is with a comparison with the game Telephone. Here's a simple example. Player A says the following. We are going to advance. Send reinforcements. Player B speaks quickly and shortens we are. We're going to advance. Send reinforcements. Player C passes on the message and changes the word advance because player B didn't pronounce the V properly, or maybe player C just misheard. We're going to a dance. Send reinforcements. Finally, player D changes the end of the message because they are unfamiliar with the word reinforcements. We're going to a dance. Send 4 cents. Ultimately, what this demonstrates is that without a systematic means of ensuring the preservation of the message, its mass memorization would be like a giant unsupervised game of telephone. Changes would inevitably creep in over time. What inspired Muslims to pay such attention to detail? When God revealed the Quran to the Prophet Muhammad, it was recited to him in a specific manner. The Quran itself commands Muslims to recite it in this same specific way. Recite the Quran slowly and distinctly. Therefore, Muslims throughout history have placed great importance on how they recite the Quran. This has led to the creation of an intricate science known as Tajweed. Tajweed sets out rules and regulations to preserve Prophet Muhammad's recitation style, down to each individual letter of the Quran. The fact that today we can find millions of Muslims of all different nationalities who are able to recite the Quran as if they themselves were Arabs living during the time of the Prophet Muhammad is proof of the effectiveness of this science in preserving the oral integrity of the text. This, in spite of the fact that there is no internationally centralized religious organization to administer such preservation. The Quran has also been preserved in meaning. Why is this important? Because you cannot separate language from scripture. As God states, the Quran is tied to the Arabic language. We have made it a Quran in Arabic. So, if we were to lose the Arabic language, we would also lose the Quran. There is no benefit in preserved scripture if we have lost the meaning of its words. In the Judaic tradition, the Torah was originally revealed to Moses over 3,000 years ago, making it over 1,500 years older than the Quran. However, the first Hebrew dictionary wasn't created until the 10th century, some 300 years after the revelation of the Quran. Hebrew was a dead language from the 2nd century CE until the foundation of Israel. In comparison, the oldest Arabic dictionary in existence was published within 200 years after the Quran. The early compilation of Arabic dictionaries has ensured that none of the meanings of the words of the Quran have ever been lost. As a consequence of this, Bible scholars had to turn to the vocabulary found in the Arabic dictionaries themselves to assist in understanding the many obscure and problematic Hebrew words in the Old Testament. Because Arabic and Hebrew are both part of the Semitic family of languages, they have many similarities. So the Arabic language has been used since the Middle Ages to understand difficult words and expressions in Biblical Hebrew. In short, to fully understand Hebrew, the language of the Old Testament, Bible scholars have had to rely on the classical Arabic, the language of the Quran. Before the revelation of the Quran, man was the caretaker of scripture and ultimately failed in this duty. Was this poor judgment on the part of God? Absolutely not. The revelation given to Moses and Jesus, peace be upon them both, were only ever meant to be time-bound scriptures which served as a temporary placeholder until the coming of the Quran. With the advent of the final messenger, Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the revelation of the final message, God took it upon himself to protect the Quran. As we have seen, in every conceivable way, the Quran has been protected. Whether it's the preservation of its content, its recitation style, or the meaning of its words, God has ensured that the Quran is the scripture mankind can be certain of. This is the scripture in which there is no doubt, containing guidance for those who are mindful of God.
Now, there are some mathematical miracles of the Quran. Throughout all the Quran, if you count some specific words, you will come across to very meaningful results. I would like to give you some examples. For instance, if you count the word punishment in the Holy Quran, throughout the whole Quran, it is repeated some 117 times. Whereas the word forgive is repeated some 234 times inside the whole Quran. 234. If you multiply 117 by 2, you're going to have 234. It is very meaningful. Why? Because Quranic morality, Allah recommends, Allah orders believers, Allah orders Muslims to forgive rather than punishing. It is very meaningful. Moreover, Allah orders to our Prophet, say, it is repeated some 332 times. And the response, they said, it is again equally repeated some 332 times. The words world and hereafter, they are repeated 115 times equally. Devil and angel, those two words are equally repeated some 88 times. Now, heaven and hell, those two words are equally repeated 77 times. Zakah is an Arabic word. Its translation is donation, the financial donation that a Muslim is supposed to give to poor. And it is repeated 32 times. And the barakah, the blessing that comes out of giving a donation to a poor, it is repeated 32 times. It is equally repeated. It is very meaningful again. Now, summer, hot, and winter, cold, those words are equally repeated 5 times. And richness and poverty, those two words, it is very interesting. Richness is repeated 26 times, whereas the poverty is half of 26, which is 13. And woman and man, those are repeated equally 23 times. Well, do you know any idea what those numbers represent? Well, let me remind you, if you remember from the chromosome numbers of a human being, from the previous slides, a human body contains 46 different chromosomes. That comes, the half of this 46, which is 23, comes from the father, and the other half, which is 23, comes from the mother. Whereas you got the same repetition number for woman and man, 23 and 23. If you add 23 to 23, you're going to have 46, which will give you the chromosome number of a human being. Now, finally, I would like to give you the meaning of land and sea. Land is repeated 13 times, whereas the word sea repeated 32 times. Well, at first sight, it doesn't seem to be very meaningful. However, if you do a simple math, you're going to have 13. If you add 32, you're going to have 45 as for the result. And the percentages, if you divide 13 to 45, you're going to have 28.88%. And 32 to 45, as for the word C, you're going to have 71.11%. Now, do you have any idea what those percentages represent? Well, I'll tell you, those numbers will give you all the lands all over the world on the earth occupies 28.88% of the whole earth, and all the seas, oceans, rivers, all the water occupies 71.11% of the whole earth. Now again, these repetition numbers are very meaningful, and it clearly represents us and gives us good scientific evidences that the Holy Quran is word of Allah, and it cannot be, definitely can't be, a scripture of a man. This is not possible. So, for more information, I would highly recommend you to visit harunyahya.com. And in harunyahya.com, you will see that all the information about the miracles of the Quran. Of course, since we are limited of time, we could just put here like 20, 30 of them. However, if you visit and read the miracles of the Quran, the word miracles of the book Miracles of the Quran from Harun Yahya, you will see that there are more than 120, 130 different scientific evidences for the miracles of the Quran. And all those informations are free, free to download, free to duplicate, free to distribute, and for your use for the cause of Islam. Thank you very much for listening.
Centuries had passed as philosophers continued to search for universal criteria for truth. In the end, such criteria was found. It was mathematics, logic's younger sister. Basis of both math and logic is order and proportion. Discovery of order enables us to see patterns and predict the development of things and events. Elegant beauty and credibility of mathematics enlightened, gave confidence, and led to the emergence of modern science. Today, science faces humanity's greatest question, the question of God, and mathematics helped to raise this question. Theory of Big Bang, which is today's standard and widely accepted framework for understanding the origins of our universe, was developed primarily by mathematical means. According to this theory, the universe appeared from the point of zero volume and infinite mass, in other words, from nothing. The Big Bang theory destroyed the barriers between science, religion, and philosophy, and added credibility to the traditional proofs of God's existence. In the process of measuring and examining this world, science raised questions that it was unable to answer. First, it was discovered that the universe had a beginning. In other words, there was a time when there was no time, as well as no matter, no energy, and no space. In other words, the world began or was created from nothing. Who created our world? Then it became clear that the laws of physics are tuned and established with such precision and perfection that it is impossible to explain their existence simply by coincidence. Who established and calculated the laws of physics? Finally, it is now evident that our innate capabilities to understand the laws of nature are amazingly well adjusted to these laws. Why do we have the ability to know? Scientific data indicates that the same cause initiated both cosmos and man. It is exactly the search for the single and universal cause of all things that inspired philosophers and scientists of all ages to make discoveries and look for truth. Behind philosophical and scientific findings lies a simple amazement before the grandeur and complexity of ordering things and events of our world. The greatest minds were convinced that observable order and unity underlying our world can only be explained through the existence of a single creator. And if the greatest of us were right, indeed, then such God would not leave us without his attention and will establish a link with mankind, favoring the efforts of the best of men who devoted and sacrificed so much studying his creation and searching for himself. We would like to present to you something both striking and curious. We call it the primary proof, the sign, the miracle. We speak of a physical object existing in reality, of an old book written more than 1,000 years ago. It is a book which contains a blend of brilliant poetry, deep prose, coherent philosophical and ethical system, scientific phenomena, and mathematical symmetries. This book contains ultimate answers to all major questions. Profoundness and integrity of these answers are capable of filling the soul of the seeker of truth with a sense of enthusiastic satisfaction from the attained goal. And the answer to the question of God will undoubtedly be the most important. The book convincingly verifies the existence of God and at the same time completely reveals his will. This concrete evidence is the mathematical code encrypted within the text. The book carries a complex mathematical structure based on proportions, symmetries, sequences, and numerical values of letters, words, sentences, and chapters. The creation of such structure is unthinkable without the application of advanced computing technology, especially considering the age of the writing. This book is the Quran. Before the might of God, thinkers attempted to understand his creation with the help of their reason. Exploring the world in search of divine traces, they achieved much and built the world we live in. The activity of these people led to revolutionary changes in lifestyle, way of thought, and colossal accomplishments in the fields of science and technology. The mathematical code of the Quran was discovered in 1974 by an American scientist, Rashad Khalifa, who attempted to uncover Quran's most important secret, mysterious sets of letters appearing in the beginning of 29 chapters. Traditional techniques proved to be unsuccessful. Rashad Khalifa decided to program the Quranic text into digital language and load it into a computer. This proved to be a wise decision since its consequences led to the great scientific discovery. Numerical code of enormous complexity was found in the Arabic text of the Quran. Mathematical structure built around a single factor, number 19. The discovery of mathematical phenomena in the Quran shook the Muslim world. For the first time in history, a physical evidence of the divine origin of the scripture was discovered. Let us repeat the experimental steps took by Dr. Khalifa in order to witness the miracle for ourselves. To see the mathematical structure of the Quran, we use Abjad, an original system of numeration by letters of Arabic alphabet. Arabic alphabet consists of 28 letters and is ideally suited for decimal numeration system. Every letter has its numerical value, from 1 to 9, from 10 to 90, from 100 to 900, and 1,000. The numerical value of a word is constituted by some value of its letters. The numerical value of an Arabic word Allah, God, will equal to the sum of its four letters. Alif, 1, Lam, 30, Lam, 30, Ha, 5, together, 66. Armed with this information, we can now easily calculate numerical values of each word, verse, and chapter in the Quran. Let's begin with Bismillah, a first verse of the book which is found exactly 114 times in the Quran. Bismillah is the most frequent verse in the Quran. It sounds like this, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. Bismillah is a perfect example to reveal the mathematical phenomena. Bismillah has 19 letters. It is easy to count even if you do not know Arabic. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. These are numerical values of each letter. By adding their values together, we can determine the values of each word and total value of all words. Their value, 102, 66, 329, and 289. Total numerical value of all words, 786. Bismillah has 4 words, 19 letters. Total numerical value of Bismillah is 786. This 6-digit number is divisible by 19 without a remainder. Let's rewrite the sequence number of each word in Bismillah and after it number of letters in each word. This whole sequence is an 8-digit number divisible by 19. If we add the number of letters in each word to the number of letters in the next word, we will get a 10-digit number divisible by 19. If we add the numerical value of each word to the number of letters in this word, we will get a 15-digit number divisible by 19. If we add the numerical value of each word to the numerical value of the next word, we will get a 16-digit number divisible by 19. If we write the number of letters in the word, then the numerical value of each letter in this word separately, then the numerical value of each word, we will get a 48-digit number divisible by 19. If we write after the numerical value of each letter its sequence number in Bismillah from 1 to 19, we will get a 62-digit number divisible by 19. The miracle of Bismillah is not limited to simple math and divisibility by 19. No less interesting are proportions between numerical values and lexical meanings of words comprising Bismillah and other attributes of God mentioned in the Quran. So, 4 words comprising Bismillah are found in the Quran. Name, 19 times. God, 2,698 times. Most Gracious, 57 times. Most Merciful, 114 times. All numbers are divisible by 19, and the addition of the quotients produces 152, which turns out to also be divisible by 19 without a remainder. Out of 115 attributes of God mentioned in the Quran, there are only 4 names whose numerical values correspond with the numbers mentioned above. These are Wahid, 1, Zul Fadl Ilazim, possessor of highest grace, Majid, glorious, Jami, gatherer. They correspond with only 3 names. There is an incomplete symmetry. The word ism, name, is not a name, so it would be logical to suppose that there is a divine name which is found exactly 19 times in the Quran, which will be correspond to the numerical value of the divine attribute Wahid, 19. Remarkable is the fact that out of 115 divine attributes dispersed throughout the whole Quran, there's only 1 name which is repeated exactly 19 times, Shaheed, witness. Thus, we have a perfect symmetrical system of interrelated divine attributes. All mentioned numerical meanings are divisible by 19. These words are easily combined into a single sentence. God is witness that He is one, possessor of the highest grace, glorious, most gracious, most merciful, gatherer of people on the day of judgment. Thank you. first sight, it all seems as some sort of manipulation and trick. Skepticism in this case is quite appropriate and reflects a sound mind. It is possible to create patterns in words, even sentences, adjusting their values accordingly. This will take lots of time and mathematical skills. History knows of such examples. However, to do such task with a whole book, literary masterpiece, historical document, religious and philosophical scripture, ethical code, and judicial compendium is unreal. Colossal complexity of such task is unimaginable. Human intellect, especially in the 7th century, is simply not fit for such task. It would take supercomputer technologies to calculate data of such magnitude. It is not without reason that Quran challenges humanity to produce a book like this. Or do they say, he invented it? Say, bring 10 invented chapters like it, and call it on whom you can besides God if you're truthful. So far, the challenge has not been accepted, and no one has been able to refute the mathematical miracle of the Quran. Will you dare? The mathematical miracle guarantees the safety of the scripture. There remains as a long-awaited, indisputable confirmation of the extraterrestrial origin of the Quran. Verse 30 of the 74th chapter says the following. On it is 19. Traditionalists say that it is about the Day of Judgment when God and angels will tempt, mislead, and guide people, and disbelievers will question God. This understanding is based on neglectful and inconsistent reading of the Quranic text. Since it is impossible to imagine that at the final judgment, God would have to mislead somebody and somebody would question God. What did God mean by this example? No. The day of final judgment is an event persuasive enough for everybody to be free of doubts about religion, scripture, or God's existence. Also, it is clear that it is not angels themselves, but their number, which is made as a test for disbelievers. So what exactly does Quran say about number 19? The Quran pays special attention to the number 19, which is meant to persuade the people of the scripture, reinforce faith of the believers, and guide them to the straight path, as well as to expose hypocrites and disbelievers and leave them in a state of misguidance. All of this must occur in this life, before the Day of Judgment. But why 19, and not 3, 5, or 100? Perhaps only in time we will understand the true purpose of the number 19 in the Quran. Nonetheless, it is safe to say that the number 19 proves the supernatural origins of the Quran and serves as the key which opens the door to a miracle. Do you want more of mathematical facts, this time without complex calculations? Okay, only proven and verified facts. By the even and the odd, says verse 3 of chapter 89, attracting our attention to the possibility of an experiment. The Quran, it contains 114 chapters. Every chapter contains a certain amount of verses. Total sum of the 114 sequence numbers is 6,555. Total amount of numbered Quranic verses is 6,234. 114 chapters of the Quran. Half of them odd sequence numbers, half even. Let's organize chapters according to the evenness and the oddness of their quantity of verses and sequence numbers. We're left with four categories. The category of two odds is a category where the sequence number and the quantity of verses are both odd. The two even category is where the sequence number and the quantity of verses are both even. The even odd category is where the sequence number and the quantity of verses are even and odd respectively. And finally, odd even category is where everything is exactly the opposite. Now let's combine categories into groups. Here we have chapters where the sequence numbers and the quantity of verses match by evens or odds. And in the other group, there are chapters where the sequence number and the quantity of verses do not match by evens and odds. Truly astonishing are the following facts. In both groups, the distribution and the number of surahs are not only symmetrical but also equal, while the sums of the surah numbers and the number of ayahs and the respective groups are equal to the sums of the same factors throughout the whole Quran. Clearly, before us is a perfect harmony, symmetry, and beauty. Code 19 is present not only in the first verse of the Quran, but literally runs through the whole first surah, Al-Fatiha. The first surah consists of 7 verses. Let us write down order number of each verse, number of words in each verse, number of letters in each verse, numerical value of each verse. Total number of words in the whole surah, 29. The number of letters in the whole surah, 139. Numerical value of all words in the surah, 10,143. Now let us represent available sequences as numbers which are divisible by 19. In the end, we get 10 patterns divisible by 19. So far, we have witnessed how code 19 works with the first verse in the first chapter of the Quran. Creation of such complex system, according to our view, far transcends the boundaries of human abilities and points to the supernatural origin of the book. Mathematical code also safeguards Bismillah and Fatiha. First verse and first chapter are clearly preserved from distortions. If it wasn't so, the code simply would not work. Is there a similar code in the whole text of the book? Yes, the structure of the Quran is mathematically regulated and follows the same pattern. Code 19 protects the whole scripture. Unfortunately, time limits do not allow us to show all examples of big numbers, and we will only show 2 of them. If we represent the Quran as a sequence of chapter numbers, verse numbers, and their sums, we'll get the following numbers. First, let's write the verse sequence numbers in chapters. Let's write total sum of verse numbers in this chapter. First chapter will look like this. The whole number will look like this. Let's try a different pattern. If we put the total sum of verse numbers before verse sequence numbers, we will get the following number. The code also works with this pattern. All these colossal numbers are divisible by 19. You can find many different patterns and sequences on our websites. In this film, we presented evidence that the Quran is not an ordinary book. Facts in the Quran deserve attention and individual testing. To do this, you do not need special skills or complex technology. All that is needed is a simple computer and a few hours to spare. The difficult part will be to look at things from a new perspective if in the process it turns out that the world no longer fits in an old framework. Science and mathematics prove that the Quran is supernatural in origin and leave the one who witnessed it one-on-one with the book which contains answers to life's most important questions. Allow us to present to you Gershom, son of Jonah from the Karyot Sons of Israel, a rational monotheist, chairman of the Leiden Institute of Rational Monotheism, or avid supporter. Since last year, Gershom has made 2 important discoveries, clear signs of the Code 19 in the Torah and the Gospel. As we know, Quran mentions a large number of prophets, but only 5 different scriptures. The scrolls of Abraham, the book of Genesis, which opens the Bible, the Torah of Moses, the Psalms of David, the Gospel, and in fact the Quran itself. So what are these discoveries made by Gershom? In this section we will briefly talk about one of them, namely the code 19 found in the Torah. The first person to mention about this code was Adib Yuksel, the student of the late Rashad Khalifa. However, complete and detailed data was unavailable at the time. Last year, in the Royal Library of Hague, on July 19th, Gershom discovered new information regarding Code 19, and thus the fragmented mosaic of details was put together into a complete body of evidence. In the library, Gershom found a book by an Israeli author, Professor Joseph Dana, which tells the story of a rabbi, Yehuda the Pious, who was involved in numerological research of the Old Testament text. As a specimen, here is a piece of the text mentioned by Adib. At first sight, it seems as if the text has no connection. He simply gives it as a model, but if we look further, something truly remarkable is happening. Here it says that he criticizes those people who add to their prayers one more of what we call verse. He states that such practice is unlawful since it leads to the increase in the number of holy names, making it 20, while it has to be 19. It attracts my attention, but Adib's text was too vague until I finally noticed a footnote under number 19, by the way. And the footnote explains this in detail, quoting a certain complete piece of the biblical text. We call it parasha, or it can also be called chapter, just like the Quran has surahs, the Pentateuch has parashas. Here we demonstrate the translation of the biblical text wherein code 19 was discovered by Gershom. And you will find 19 times the word Elohim, that is God, in the weekly chapter in the Torah. You will also find 19 signs in the description of the sixth day of creation in chapter Genesis, that is the scrolls of Abraham. And also you will find that the Almighty, blessed be He, is called the Father of all things 19 times, and 19 times the prayer, Sliha in the Pentateuch. And 19 times in the Pentateuch, Abrahamic formula is cited, Isaac and Jacob, and there is 19 blessings in the chapters of the Torah. It is known now that Rabbi Yehuda the Pious claimed that such 19 word sets are amazingly interwoven within the text of the Torah. It is known that Yehuda the Pious wrote 8 volumes on this subject, but unfortunately they have not survived. Also, it is worthy of mentioning that Yehuda had done his numerological studies of the sacred scriptures without being a Kabbalist. According to Gershom, the evidence for the presence of the Code 19 was discovered not just in the Torah, but in the Gospel as well. In May of this year, such data became available. Our Cariot friend explains that a four-lettered name of God, the Tetragrammaton, is found exactly 19 times in the text of the Hebrew Gospel of Matthew, which is the most authentic and ancient of the existing versions, according to the early church fathers. It should be noted that the Tetragrammaton, the name of God of the ancient Hebrews, is considered to be so sacred that the Judaists are afraid to even say it out loud. Instead, they denote it in the post-biblical text with the letter He. Gershom is convinced that the Code 19 is the key to preserving the text of the scriptures from the corrupted clergy, as well as to prove their divine origin.
Вообразим такую
Let us imagine a situation. A certain group of students runs into a classroom. The bell has ringed, the classroom is still empty, and the students are left unsupervised. The desks have paper cards left by an anonymous teacher. They are simple squares with color images painted on them. The board has an unexplained rebus drawn on it. How will the students react? One thing's for sure, they will act differently. Some will remain disinterested. Others, after a brief look at the cards, will toss them aside, maybe even rip them apart, or even interrupt other students from examining them. Some will realize that the cards have certain meaning and purpose, but greed and lust for power will force them to use the cards to fulfill their personal selfish goals. They will turn the colored squares into idols and objects of worship, while they themselves become mediators and clerics, enjoying all the added benefits. There will also be those who will focus their attention on examining one single card, given in a deep and thorough analysis. Such method will deprive the rest of the cards from attention and will not contribute towards solving the rebus. The behavior of the students will vary. Reactions will be infantile, selfish, reckless, and even aggressive. Thus ignoring the main questions regarding the origins, meaning, and the ultimate purpose of the cards. While only a handful will try to uncover semantic relationships between the cards. These minds will put the cards in the order of their meaning, noting the similarities and differences. Eventually, after drawing their attention to the rebus, they will finally be able to solve it. Those who discover the secret behind the cards using their reasoning will deserve the praise from the teacher. After all, they decided to break free from the intellectual infantilism, gathered enough courage, and chose to be wise. They will deserve the attention of the teacher, the one who plays the cards in the rebus in the classroom. The others, on the contrary, will lose. At the moment of the final bell, everyone will realize the importance of the rebus on the wall. However, at the moment, it will be too late to try to solve it. What if God operates in a similar fashion? He creates an enormous world full of countless things and creatures. He created this world according to strict mathematical laws and harmonies. He sends into this world signs in the forms of scriptures that are mathematically structured and proportioned. And all this is done to distinguish those among people who achieve the best results in applying their God-given abilities of reason and will for truth. Perhaps the world is an immense scripture wherein one shouldn't simply glance over separate images or read through summaries of events, but to contemplate on and understand the inherent purpose of the author.
The arrangement of the Quran is one of many reasons why Muslims believe that it could only have come from God. In fact, modern research has discovered a remarkable structure in the Quran known as ring composition. To demonstrate this, let's analyze the second chapter of the Quran known as Al-Baqarah, the cow. This chapter consists of a total of 286 verses. The entire chapter can be divided into 9 groups based on theme. The first group of verses talk about faith and unbelief. This mirrors the theme of the last group of verses. The second group covers God's creation and knowledge. This again mirrors the second to the last group's theme. The third group discusses the law given to the Israelites, which mirrors the giving of law to the Muslims in the seventh group. The fourth group relates to the test of Abraham, a mirror of the test of Muslims in the sixth group. The middle group, the fifth group, is the central theme of the entire chapter, the change in direction of the Muslim prayer. We have made you believers a middle nation, so that you may bear witness to the truth before others. We only made the direction the one you used to face in order to distinguish those who follow the messenger from those who turn on their heels. This turning point was the change in direction of the daily prayers from Jerusalem to Mecca, which represented a big test for the believers. We find the mention of this important turning point in exactly the middle of the chapter, the 143rd verse. Moreover, this verse even contains the word middle. Together, these 9 groups form a giant ring composition. As you can see, ring composition is structured as a sort of circle, with the central meaning placed at the center. You can think of it in terms of a mirror. So ring composition is the equivalent of putting a mirror in the middle. What is mentioned in the first half will be reflected in the second half. Things can be taken a step further. If we examine these 9 groups, we find that they each contain sub-ring compositions. So what we have is rings within rings. For example, here is the 8th group with the theme of God's creation and knowledge. We can see that the beginning and the end both have the themes of giving and charity, and the central theme of God's power and knowledge is placed in the middle. Things can be taken further still. This sub-ring contains yet another ring within itself. This is the 255th verse known as Ayat al-Kursi, the verse of the throne. Just like the chapter which contains it, the verse of the throne can be divided into 9 groups based on theme. The first and ninth parts each mention God's personal names. The second and eighth parts both state that God never tires. The third and seventh parts describe that God owns everything in the heavens and the earth. The fourth and sixth parts make it clear that God has total control over us and we are dependent on Him. Notice that the middle of this verse mentions before and after, which could be yet another allusion to the mirroring of ring composition. It's worth highlighting that not only does the verse of the throne contain its own ring composition, but it is also positioned as a sub-ring within 2 larger rings, a concentric ring composition. We can see that this chapter of the Quran is marvelously designed, being precisely and tightly arranged according to the principles of ring composition. This precision in arrangement is in fact astonishing when we consider the timing of the revelation of these verses. To appreciate this, let's consider the analogy of building construction. Imagine you had the task of building a house. Rather than waiting until you receive all of the materials and then drawing up a carefully thought out design plan, you instead decide to proceed without complete knowledge of the constituent parts, constructing it piecemeal, adding to it bit by bit as and when you receive the individual materials. What are the chances that this approach will result in a well-constructed house? Unlike an organized approach where each part is placed in its best possible position according to a design plan, instead you have a situation where it seems each part is placed arbitrarily, depending on the order in which the parts were received. In such circumstances, you would most likely end up with a very poorly designed house, liable to collapse at any time. It is highly unlikely, perhaps even impossible, that this disorganized approach would end up with the same stunningly designed house as an organized approach. Yet this is exactly what we find with the Quran's structure. The builder in our example is the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The house that he began to build since its first verses were revealed to him is the Quran. The rooms and bricks in our construction example are its chapters and verses. He can never have a design plan in place for the Quran because the revelation of many of its verses depended on events that were out of his control, such as the social developments and challenges that he faced throughout his prophethood. For example, believers would come up to him and question him on a particular matter, or his enemies would challenge him. The responses in the form of revelation would then descend on him, addressing the specific situation that he was facing. How could Muhammad have devised such an intricate plan when he could not predict the events that would dictate the revelation of verses? Such an arrangement would have to be planned in advance, but this was not possible due to these events being out of his control. What this demonstrates is that the author was someone who could predict the future. Possessing knowledge of the unseen is a quality of God, not human beings. Some critics may point out that books prior to the Quran had this literary style and therefore we cannot use this as an evidence for the Quran's divine origin. However, comparing the Quran to other books is like comparing night and day for many reasons. Firstly, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was not a poet nor did he have any literary reputation. In fact, like many people at the time, he could not read or write. Secondly, most people would assume that the Quran is arranged chronologically, starting with the first revealed verse and ending with the final revealed verse. This is the order in which books are typically written, in a logical sequence, starting with the beginning, then the middle, and finally the end. But the way the Quran was composed is unlike any other book. Al-Baqarah, the chapter of the Quran that we have covered, was not revealed starting with verse 1, followed by verse 2, then 3, and so on. Rather, its verses were revealed out of sequence, over a span of many years, and interspaced with the revelation of verses from other chapters. The Quran's unusual manner of revelation makes implementing ring composition much more difficult than conventional books. Thirdly, conventional books follow an editorial process by undergoing multiple stages of editing, which allows the author to gradually refine the text over time. However, the Quran did not undergo an editorial process. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, would place the verses in their positions as soon as they were revealed to him. With each new verse, he would not go off and review what had been previously revealed to see where he can position them in order to maintain a ring structure. Rather, spontaneous revelation was immediately followed by the placement of the verse, its position fixed. When we look at the history of the Quran's compilation, there is not a single instance of a verse being moved around in order to make it fit a ring composition. Fourthly, achieving ring composition in conventional books is much more feasible as the author has complete control over the content, allowing them to plan their structure ahead of time. As we've already seen with the Quran, its content was circumstantial as it was tied to events that were out of the control of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and therefore he could not plan a structure ahead of time. Fifthly, the Quran was first revealed as an oral recitation, not in written format. With written books, you can easily plan a structure because you can quickly and conveniently refer back to what you have written previously. But with a recited text like the Quran, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, would have had to rely on his memory in order to recall what was previously revealed, a much greater challenge. In light of all these difficult circumstances, wouldn't you expect the Quran's structure to be jumbled? What we find, against all odds, however, is that the Quran contains a remarkably sophisticated structure. The circumstances of the Quran's revelation, together with its precision and harmony, represent a compelling argument for its divine origin. Your companion is neither astray nor being misled, nor does he say anything of his own desire. It is no less than inspiration sent down to him. He was taught by one mighty in power.
What are the qualities that one would expect to find in genuine revelation from God? If the Creator is perfect and has knowledge of all things, then surely his true revelation must be free of error. Anything less than this can only lead to one conclusion. We are dealing with the imperfect words of man and not the divine. History has not been kind to scripture. The vast majority of religious texts today have been passed down to us through scribal tradition, whereby manuscripts were copied by hand, word for word, letter by letter. Naturally, this method of preservation is prone to human error. Any mistakes, such as in spelling or missing words, made whilst copying, would then be transferred down every time a copy of the copy was made. Extend this process over hundreds or thousands of years, and you can imagine how much a text can change over such a long span of time, as accidental and intentional changes gradually creep in. This is why, for example, we find that there are a multitude of different versions of the Bible in existence today. It's not possible to compare the modern text to the earliest copies, because they were written on fragile and perishable materials, such as papyrus. Therefore, scholars of the Bible have the difficult task of sifting through thousands of later copies, all of which differ. And because the original copies have been lost, they can't agree on which surviving copies are most accurate to the original. So, each version of the Bible that exists is a patchwork of different copies combined together and represents what a particular scholar or group of scholars estimate to be the closest to the original. And so, for texts that have relied on preservation through manual copying, we can say that we have, at best, an estimate of the original words. We certainly cannot say that the text we have today is an accurate representation of the original. What about the Qur'an? The author of the Qur'an makes a bold claim. We have sent down the Qur'an ourselves, and we ourselves will guard it. God blessed his final revelation, the Qur'an, with something that was not bestowed on any of the prior scriptures. He promised to protect and preserve it from any corruption. Unlike other scriptures, the primary means of preserving the Qur'an has and always will be through memorization. And we have certainly made the Qur'an easy for remembrance. So is there any who will remember? Prophet Muhammad was tasked by God with memorizing, transmitting, and explaining the verses of the Qur'an to the Muslims as they were revealed to him. In turn, these Muslims who had learnt the Qur'an directly from Prophet Muhammad himself passed on what they had memorized to neighboring tribes and nations. This legacy of mass memorization has continued throughout history. This oral tradition spanning nearly 1500 years has seen the Qur'an being passed down from teacher to student in an unbroken chain going all the way back to Prophet Muhammad himself. Today, it is estimated there are many millions of Muslims of all cultures and various ages who have memorized the entire Qur'an from cover to cover in its original Arabic form. In fact, if every written copy of religious scripture in existence today were to be removed from the earth, it is the Qur'an alone that could be recreated perfectly and restored in written form once again. This, thanks to its mass memorization. The oral tradition of the Qur'an is a phenomenon unique to Islam. If millions of people who have memorized the Qur'an can trace their oral memorization down centuries of teachers and scholars, all the way back to the Prophet himself, who could doubt the authenticity of this oral tradition? The amount of varying oral transmissions, along with the amount of people who have learnt the Qur'an, and the fact there are no discrepancies in what they have memorized, is no historical coincidence. The conclusion can only be that the Qur'an memorized today is the same as it was taught over 1400 years ago. There is no other rational explanation for this unique oral phenomenon. In addition to the mass memorization of the Qur'an, another unique aspect of its preservation is that the rules and regulations for pronouncing each individual letter have also been safeguarded. This ensures that Muslims not only recite the same content as Prophet Muhammad, but in the exact same style. An easy way to appreciate the significance of preserving the recitation style of the Qur'an is with a comparison with the game Telephone. Here's a simple example. Player A says the following. We are going to advance. Send reinforcements. Player B speaks quickly and shortens we are. We're going to advance. Send reinforcements. Player C passes on the message and changes the word advance because player B didn't pronounce the V properly, or maybe player C just misheard. We're going to a dance. Send reinforcements. Finally, player D changes the end of the message because they are unfamiliar with the word reinforcements. We're going to a dance. Send 4 cents. Ultimately, what this demonstrates is that without a systematic means of ensuring the preservation of the message, its mass memorization would be like a giant unsupervised game of telephone. Changes would inevitably creep in over time. What inspired Muslims to pay such attention to detail? When God revealed the Quran to the Prophet Muhammad, it was recited to him in a specific manner. The Quran itself commands Muslims to recite it in this same specific way. Recite the Quran slowly and distinctly. Therefore, Muslims throughout history have placed great importance on how they recite the Quran. This has led to the creation of an intricate science known as Tajweed. Tajweed sets out rules and regulations to preserve Prophet Muhammad's recitation style, down to each individual letter of the Quran. The fact that today we can find millions of Muslims of all different nationalities who are able to recite the Quran as if they themselves were Arabs living during the time of the Prophet Muhammad is proof of the effectiveness of this science in preserving the oral integrity of the text. This, in spite of the fact that there is no internationally centralized religious organization to administer such preservation. The Quran has also been preserved in meaning. Why is this important? Because you cannot separate language from scripture. As God states, the Quran is tied to the Arabic language. We have made it a Quran in Arabic. So, if we were to lose the Arabic language, we would also lose the Quran. There is no benefit in preserved scripture if we have lost the meaning of its words. In the Judaic tradition, the Torah was originally revealed to Moses over 3,000 years ago, making it over 1,500 years older than the Quran. However, the first Hebrew dictionary wasn't created until the 10th century, some 300 years after the revelation of the Quran. Hebrew was a dead language from the 2nd century CE until the foundation of Israel. In comparison, the oldest Arabic dictionary in existence was published within 200 years after the Quran. The early compilation of Arabic dictionaries has ensured that none of the meanings of the words of the Quran have ever been lost. As a consequence of this, Bible scholars had to turn to the vocabulary found in the Arabic dictionaries themselves to assist in understanding the many obscure and problematic Hebrew words in the Old Testament. Because Arabic and Hebrew are both part of the Semitic family of languages, they have many similarities. So the Arabic language has been used since the Middle Ages to understand difficult words and expressions in biblical Hebrew. In short, to fully understand Hebrew, the language of the Old Testament, Bible scholars have had to rely on the classical Arabic, the language of the Quran. Before the revelation of the Quran, man was the caretaker of scripture and ultimately failed in this duty. Was this poor judgment on the part of God? Absolutely not. The revelation given to Moses and Jesus, peace be upon them both, were only ever meant to be time-bound scriptures which served as a temporary placeholder until the coming of the Quran. With the advent of the final messenger, Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the revelation of the final message, God took it upon himself to protect the Quran. As we have seen, in every conceivable way, the Quran has been protected. Whether it's the preservation of its content, its recitation style, or the meaning of its words, God has ensured that the Quran is the scripture mankind can be certain of. This is the scripture in which there is no doubt, containing guidance for those who are mindful of God.
Now, there are some mathematical miracles of the Quran. Throughout all the Quran, if you count some specific words, you will come across to very meaningful results. I would like to give you some examples. For instance, if you count the word punishment in the Holy Quran, throughout the whole Quran, it is repeated some 117 times. Whereas the word forgive is repeated some 234 times inside the whole Quran. 234. If you multiply 117 by 2, you're going to have 234. It is very meaningful. Why? Because Quranic morality, Allah recommends, Allah orders believers, Allah orders Muslims to forgive rather than punishing. It is very meaningful. Moreover, Allah orders to our Prophet, say, it is repeated some 332 times. And the response, they said, it is again equally repeated some 332 times. The words world and hereafter, they are repeated 115 times equally. Devil and angel, those two words are equally repeated some 88 times. Now, heaven and hell, those two words are equally repeated 77 times. Zakah is an Arabic word, its translation is donation. The financial donation that a Muslim is supposed to give to poor. And it is repeated 32 times. And the barakah, the blessing that comes out of giving a donation to a poor, it is repeated 32 times. It is equally repeated. It is very meaningful again. Now, summer, hot, and winter, cold, those words are equally repeated 5 times. And richness and poverty, those two words, it is very interesting. Richness is repeated 26 times, whereas the poverty is half of 26, which is 13. And woman and man, those are repeated equally 23 times. Well, do you know any idea what those numbers represent? Well, let me remind you, if you remember from the chromosome numbers of a human being, from the previous slides, a human body contains 46 different chromosomes. That comes, the half of this 46, which is 23, comes from the father, and the other half, which is 23, comes from the mother. Whereas you got the same repetition number for woman and man, 23 and 23. If you add 23 to 23, you're going to have 46, which will give you the chromosome number of a human being. Now, finally, I would like to give you the meaning of land and sea. Land is repeated 13 times, whereas the word sea repeated 32 times. Well, at first sight, it doesn't seem to be very meaningful. However, if you do a simple math, you're going to have 13. If you add 32, you're going to have 45 as for the result. And the percentages, if you